Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the day 25th February 2021. These are the list of news articles chosen for today's discussion. They are given along with the page numbers of different editions. The link for the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping for the discussed articles are provided in the description box as well as in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone users. Now let us move on to the analysis of the first news article. Now see this lead column from editorial page, which was written in the context of fall of the government in the Union Territory of Puducherry. So as you know, few MLAs of ruling Congress party have resigned, which led to a fall in the majority of the government, which resigned later. A similar case happened in 2019 in the state of Karnataka. So when you look at both the cases, you find that the governments lost majority and resigned. But there is a familiar pattern to the resignations of members of the Legislative Assembly. Such resignations are invariably leading to the fall of the government, and the resignations are taking place only from the ruling parties in the states, which are opposed to the ruling parties at the center. So in this context, let's have a brief discussion on the political system in the Union Territories and why the present system or the present setup in Union Territories with legislature is not a democratically feasible one. The syllabus for this news article is given below. See, at the time of independence, there was an abundance of princely states and former British India provinces. The Indian constitution that came into force in 1950, it recognized four different categories of territories in Schedule 1. In this, Part A comprised former British India provinces having a governor and a legislature, and Part B comprised former princely states that was governed by a Raj Pramukh, while Part C was a combination of princely states and chief commissioner's provinces that was being governed by a chief commissioner. So when you see, the administrators of all these three categories were appointed by the president. And Part D comprised the lone territory of Andaman and Nicobar Islands, which had a lieutenant governor who was appointed by the central government. So this part formed the basis for the creation of Union Territories. So now let's see the basic difference between a state and an union territory. See, a state is a unit in itself with elected representatives and its own government. They make the law and in effect, they run the state as the central government runs the country. In addition, a state also has got a governor who is appointed by the president with powers equivalent to that of the president. So as you can see, there is a clear division of powers with respect to the center and state, and they are supreme in their own spheres. When you take a union territory, it is administered wholly by the central government through the lieutenant governor as appointed by the president, making regulations for the peace, progress and good government of these union territories. Further, a union territory can even have an elected government like that of Puducherry, Delhi and the most recent union territory of Jammu and Kashmir. But the administrative powers in this case are tilted in the favor of the lieutenant governor, who is appointed by the president on the advice of the union government. So coming back to the article, it says that if the ruling party in the union territory and at the center are different, as in the case of Puducherry, it becomes very difficult to administer for the ruling government in the union territory. So the basic question here is why the constitution makers or the parliament thought to provide a legislature and a council of ministers to some of the union territories. The reason is to fulfill the democratic aspirations of the people of these union territories. So therefore, the creation of a legislature and a council of ministers is logical, and it is found to be in line with the policy of the state to promote democracy. See, Article 239A was brought in through the 14th Constitutional Amendment in the year 1962. This amendment enabled the parliament to create legislatures for the union territories, and accordingly, the union government enacted the Government of Union Territory Act in the year 1963 to create legislature for certain union territories. And as per Article 239A, legislature is a body that is elected or partly elected and partly nominated. Further, there can be a council of ministers without a legislature, or there can be a legislature as well as a council of ministers. See, in parliamentary system and in our constitutional scheme, a legislature is a law-making body, and a legislative proposal is initiated by the government, which is responsible to the legislature. So neither can the legislature exist without a council of ministers, nor can the council of ministers exist without a legislature. Interestingly, in the case of union territories, there can be a legislature without a council of ministers or a council of ministers without a legislature. Similarly, a legislature that is partly elected and partly nominated is another absurdity. So the most shocking fact is a simple amendment in the Government of Union Territories Act of 1963 can create a legislature with more than 50% of nominated members. Now here comes a question: whether will a nominated house promote representative democracy? Now coming back to Puducherry case, the issue of nomination of members to the Puducherry Assembly has raised a huge controversy, and the Government of Union Territories Act of 1963 provides for a 33-member house for Puducherry, of whom 3 are to be nominated by the central government. So when the union government nominated 3 members to the assembly without even consulting the government, it was challenged in the court. Then the Supreme Court in K. Lakshmi Narayanan case of 2019 held that the union government is not required to consult the union territory government for nominating members to the assembly, and the nominated members have got the same right to vote as the elected members. Also, you should note that this 1963 Act does not provide any criteria or qualifications to nominate members to assembly. So, if a different party runs the government in the Union Territory, this provision can be used by the Union Government with a vengeance, as that which happened in Puducherry. Now here comes the most controversial part, that is the role of an administrator. See, Article 239 says that every union territory shall be administered by the president through an administrator to be appointed by the president. In some union territories, including Puducherry, the designation of administrator is Lieutenant Governor, and in other union territories, it is just an administrator. See, the author says that the union territories were never given a fully democratic setup with necessary autonomy, and the power is tilted towards administrator. With the right, see, the administrator has got the right to disagree with the decisions of the Council of Ministers, and he can then refer them to the president for a final decision, and the president will finally decide on the advice of the union government. So this shows that it is the union government which finally determines the disputed issue, and the administrator can in fact disagree with all crucial decisions, including day-to-day policy decisions that is taken by the state government. Now here, some respite was provided through NCT of Delhi versus the Union of India of 2019. See, this NCT of Delhi versus the Union of India was a civil appeal that was heard before the Supreme Court of India by a 5-judge constitution bench of the court. And the constitution bench of the Supreme Court said that the administrator should not misuse this power to frustrate the functioning of elected government in the territory, and should use it after all methods have failed to reconcile the differences between him and the Council of Ministers. But this verdict is often ignored by the administrators. So in simple words, no union government really likes the idea of a free and autonomous government in the union territories, and therefore it tries to control it through the administrator. The weaponization of the constitutional provision happens fully when the union territory is ruled by a different political party. So experience shows that the union territories having legislature with ultimate control vested in the central administrator are not workable. So the governments at the center should respect the people's mandate, and therefore they should not involve or interfere in the day-to-day policies of union territories for better efficiency and governance. With this, let's move on to the next news article. This op-ed article talks about the role of federalism or decentralization in the context of human capital and the issues associated with it. Let us see these aspects now. The syllabus for this news article is highlighted below for your reference. First, what is human capital? See, human capital corresponds to any stock of knowledge or characteristics that the worker has which contributes to his or her productivity. Such knowledge or characteristics could be innate as well as acquired. So therefore, human capital is an intangible asset, and it consists of the knowledge, skills and health that people invest in and accumulate throughout their lives, which enables them to realize their potential as productive members of society. Economic growth and development depend on human capital, and it is the key factor to end extreme poverty and to create more inclusive societies. Thus, to develop human capital, there is a need to invest in interventions like nutrition, health, healthcare, quality education, jobs and skills, etc. Now let's see what is India's position in this investment. See, the position of India in its investment in interventions is not so appreciable, and this is visible in the rank and score of India in Human Capital Index of 2020. See, the index measures the contribution of health and education to the productivity of the individuals and countries. India's rank is 116th and it is scored just 0.49%. So this means that a child born in India today will be only 49% as productive when she grows up as she could be if she enjoyed complete education and full health. And along with this, there are also other surveys and reports in which India did not perform well. The main reason behind this is that the government interventions did not materialize. See, interventions in health, education and skill are better in India, and we have many schemes for that, such as the Poshan Abhiyan and the Samagra Siksha Abhiyan, etc. But the problem is these schemes or interventions did not materialize into better outcomes. And one of the reason for this is India's issues around decentralization. See, studies suggest a positive correlation between decentralization and human capital. That is, the better decentralization, better will be the human capital. See, generally, decentralization is delegation of authority throughout the organization, and in polity, a government is said to be decentralized when power is taken away from the central government and state governments and it is given to a third tier of the government, which is called as local government. So, as you know, local government is government that is set up at the village and district level. In 1992, Constitution was amended by 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendments in order to make the third tier more powerful and effective. See, the 73rd Amendment is about rural local governments or the Panchayati Raj institutions, and the 74th Amendment made the provisions related to urban local governments or Nagar Palikas or municipalities. Further, on coming to the fiscal front, in order to address the imbalances of revenue between the center and states, the constitution provides for fiscal transfers through tax devolution and grants in aid. See, these are covered under the section distribution of revenues between the union and the states of the constitution, which comes under articles 268 to 281. Say, for example, Article 275 provides the provision of general and specific statutory grants under which Parliament can make grants to the states which are in need of financial assistance. Additionally, Centre is empowered to provide discretionary grants under Article 282 of the Constitution for public purpose. Now let us see what are the issues. See, the first issue is that under Constitution, the state governments determine how local governments are empowered. See, we have the 11th and 12th schedules of the constitution which list the matters on which the Panchayati Raj institutions and the municipalities respectively have powers. These matters are identified from state list and they are listed in the respective schedules to be transferred to the Panchayati Raj institutions or municipalities. But the actual transfer of these functions depend upon the state legislation. See, each state decides how many of these matters would be transferred to local bodies. So this results in vast disparities when it comes to the role played by the local governments. The second issue is with respect to the centralized nature of India's fiscal architecture, which restricts state autonomy in developmental issues. This is seen in the way how statutory and discretionary grants are provided. See, the fact is that discretionary grants form a larger part of central grants to the state when compared to statutory grants. It is because the centrally sponsored schemes of the government are being funded through Article 282 only and not under Article 275. Because Article 275 requires the recommendation from Finance Commission in order to provide that grant. But grants under Article 282 two are discretionary, and these centrally sponsored schemes covers most of the social sector subjects under state and concurrent list. Thus, the state lose their autonomy in allocation of resources on most development issues within their jurisdiction, and also they lose their fiscal space. So therefore, they cannot implement plans according to their needs. Coming to the next issue about the state finance commissions. See, in many states, state finance commissions have not been constituted, and state finance commissions are mandated by constitution to make recommendations for matters like tax devolution and grants in aid to the third tier governments. So based on these issues, authors have suggested these solutions that are given below. So we hope that all these will ensure a better way forward towards developing human capital. With this info, let's move on to the next news article. Now let us take up this news article. It talks about an analysis that was done by the Center for Science and Environment on air pollution levels in Indian cities. The analysis was done by comparing the winter pollution levels of Indian cities between 2019 and 2020. And the research found that the levels of PM2.5 or particulate matter 2.5 in winter worsened in 43 out of 99 cities in 2020 in comparison to 2019 levels. And only 19 cities registered substantial improvement in air quality. The cities with the worst pollution spikes in 2020 over 2019 includes Kolkata, Gurugram, Lucknow, Jaipur, Visakhapatnam, Agra, Navi Mumbai and Jodhpur. And Mysuru is the least polluted city, followed by Satna in Madhya Pradesh and Kochi in Kerala. And also Ghaziabad is the most polluted city in the northern belt. So in this context, let us have a good understanding about particulate matter. The syllabus for this news article is given below. See, particulate matter, also known as particle pollution, is a complex mixture of extremely small particles and liquid droplets. This particulate matter is made up of a number of components, which includes acids like nitrates and sulfates, then organic chemicals, metals, soil or dust particles, then particle bound water, hydrocarbons, etc. In addition, biological components such as allergen, which includes pollen, dust mites, and microbial compounds like fungi are also a part of this particulate matter. Also know that these particles come in many sizes and shapes and can be made up of hundreds of different chemicals. Here you should know that particles which are of 10 micrometers in diameter or smaller than that generally have the capability to pass through the throat and nose and they enter into our lungs. So once they are inhaled, these particles can affect the heart and lungs and they are capable of causing serious health effects to us. So in this regard, particle pollution can be grouped into two categories. The first category consists of inhalable coarse particles such as those that are found near roadways and dusty industries. These particles are larger than 2.5 micrometers and smaller than 10 micrometers in diameter. The second type of particle pollution is made by fine particles, and these are those that can be found in smoke and haze. They range to about 2.5 micrometers in diameter or smaller than that, and these particles can be directly emitted from sources like forest fires, or they can even be formed when gases from power plants, industries and automobiles come in contact with the air. Now let's see what are the sources of this particulate matter. See, some are emitted directly from a source like construction sites or unpaved roads, fields, smokestacks or fires, etc. But most of the particles form in the atmosphere as a result of complex reactions of chemicals such as sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxide, which are usually pollutants that are emitted from power plants, industries and automobiles. Now let's see the dangers posed by this particulate matter. See, this particulate matter contains microscopic solids or liquid droplets that are so small that they can be inhaled and cause serious health problems. Particles less than 10 micrometers in diameter can get deep into your lungs and some may even get into your bloodstream. Of these particles, those that are less than 2.5 micrometers in diameter are known as fine particles or PM2.5, and it is this particle that pose the greatest risk to health. Now, according to the World Health Organization, almost 3.7 million premature deaths annually are attributed to this outdoor air pollution, and about 80% of those deaths are due to heart disease and stroke, while another 20% are from respiratory illness and cancers related to exposure to this particulate matter 2.5. Fine particles are also the main cause of reduced visibility, or what we call as haze, and this can be very dangerous to motorists. As you know, we frequently hear about accidents on the Yamuna Express Highway due to this reduced visibility that is caused by haze. According to the National Ambient Air Quality Standards of the Central Pollution Control Board of India, the 24-hour average of particulate matter 10 is 100 microgram or cubic meter and 60 microgram or cubic meter for particulate matter 2.5. With this information, let us move on to the next news article. This news article mentions that a new chairman has taken charge at the National Commission for Scheduled Caste. See, in this context, let us know about this National Commission for Scheduled Caste. First, it is a constitutional body that was set up under Article 338 of Indian Constitution. This is a new commission that came into existence in 2004, and it was inserted into the Constitution by the 89th Constitutional Amendment Act of 2003. It is because previously there was a single commission as National Commission for Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes, which has now been bifurcated into National Commission for Scheduled Caste and National Commission for Scheduled Tribes. Its objective is to oversee the implementation of the various safeguards that is provided to the scheduled caste under the Constitution. And further, under Article 338, the Constitution has assigned these duties and functions to the Commission. The first duty is to investigate and monitor all matters relating to the safeguards provided for the scheduled caste under the Constitution or under any other law or order, and to evaluate the working of such safeguards. Secondly, the National Commission for Scheduled Caste has to inquire into specific complaints with respect to the deprivation of rights and safeguards of scheduled caste. Next, to participate and advise in the planning process of socio-economic development of the scheduled caste and to evaluate the progress of their development under the union or state. It also needs to present reports to the president upon the working of those safeguards, either annually or otherwise. And such reports should contain the recommendations regarding the measures to be taken by the concerned states or union territories for the effective implementation of safeguards and other measures for the protection, welfare and socio-economic development of scheduled caste, etc. Now, to undertake these duties or functions, the National Commission for Scheduled Caste has been given all the powers of a civil court with respect to the matters displayed below. And most importantly, the Constitution provides for mandatory consultation by the union and state governments with the Commission on all major policy matters that affects the scheduled caste. And this is in accordance with Article 338, Clause 9. So this helps the Commission to keep track of all the major policy decisions, legislative or executive action that are taken by the Government of India or any state government for that matters. And further, as per Clause 10, the Commission is also required to discharge similar functions with regard to the Anglo-Indian community as it does with respect to this scheduled caste. That is, the Commission has to investigate all matters relating to the constitutional and other legal safeguards for the Anglo-Indian community, and they should report it to the President. Coming to the composition of the National Commission for Scheduled Caste, it consists of a chairperson, a vice chairperson and three other members, and they are appointed by the President. The conditions of service and tenure of office are as per the 2004 rules, according to which the chairperson shall be appointed from among eminent socio-political workers belonging to the scheduled caste, and at least one member shall be appointed from among women. See, this article, which is with reference to the PLI scheme for pharmaceuticals, IT hardware. The news is that Union Cabinet has approved the production-linked incentive scheme for the pharmaceuticals and IT hardware sectors. See, the PLI scheme for pharmaceuticals will be for 9 years till 2028 to 2029. It will benefit domestic manufacturers and also it will help in creating employment. So this scheme is expected to promote the production of high value products in the country and also to increase the value addition in exports. Now, coming to the PLI scheme for IT hardware such as laptops, tablets, all-in-one PCs and servers, under this an incentive will be given on net incremental sales of goods manufactured in India for a period of 4 years. This is an important segment to promote manufacturing under Atmanirbhar Bharat, as there is a huge import reliance for these items at present. Further, it also enhances the development of the electronics ecosystem in the country. See, both the schemes promote investment in these sectors, and as a result, the employment opportunities will be enhanced. And if you see, the PLI scheme has been in use for the last many months. Initially, the government has announced a PLI scheme for medical devices, mobile phones, and specified active pharmaceutical ingredients. Later, this scheme was expanded to many sectors, including food processing, telecom, electronics, textiles, specialty steel, automobiles, etc. And as said before, today's news is that this scheme is now being extended to pharmaceuticals and IT hardware. So just have an idea that in any PLI scheme, an incentive, that is the production linked incentive of certain percentage, is offered to companies on incremental sales of goods manufactured in India and are covered under target segments. See, incremental sales is the key word. If a company under PLI scheme sold 100 units last year, and if the same company sells 120 units this year, then incentive will be offered for that increased 20 units by the government. With this, we have come to the end of this particular news article. With this, let us now move on to the practice question discussion. Now look at this prelims practice question. It says, consider the following statements with reference to particulate matter. Statement 1 says that particles of size more than 2.5 micrometers but less than 10 micrometers in diameter pose the greatest risk to health when compared to particles of less than 2.5 micrometers. Statement 2, the 24-hour average for particulate matter 10 as assigned by the National Ambient Air Quality Standards is 100. So we need to find the correct statement. So when you look at statement 1, it is incorrect because particles less than 2.5 micrometers in diameter, which is also called as fine particles or particulate matter 2.5. Statement 1 is incorrect because it is not those particle matters of size more than 2.5 meters that pose the great health, but rather it is the particles that is less than 2.5 micrometers in diameter, which is also called as fine particles or particulate matter 2.5, which poses a greater threat or a greater risk to human health. And when you take statement 2, as seen in the discussion, according to the National Ambient Air Quality Standards of Central Pollution Control Board, the 24-hour average of particulate matter 10 is 100 microgram per cubic meter and 60 microgram per cubic meter for particulate matter 2.5. So therefore, second statement is right. And since the question asks us to identify the right statement, the right answer is option B, that is 2 only. Now look at this question about the National Commission for Scheduled Caste. The question wants us to identify the correct statement. So the first statement is, the constitution mandates for consultation by the union and state government with the National Commission for Scheduled Caste on all major policy matters affecting scheduled caste. Second statement says that the National Commission for Scheduled Caste is required by the constitution to discharge similar functions with regard to the other backward classes or OBCs and the Anglo-Indian community as it does with respect to the scheduled caste. Now we have to identify the correct statement. When you look at statement 1, as seen in the discussion, this consultation is mandatory under constitution and it was mandated under article 338 clause 9. So therefore this statement is correct. Now when you look at the second statement, this is incorrect because, see, before 2018, under article 338 clause 10, the National Commission for Scheduled Caste was required to discharge similar functions to the OBCs and Anglo-Indian community. But the Constitution 102nd Amendment Act of 2018 omitted OBC from the article. So at present, currently, the National Commission for Scheduled Caste will discharge similar functions only to the Anglo-Indian community. Therefore, the right answer is option A, that is 1 only. Now look at this prelims practice question regarding the performance linked incentive. So we need to identify the wrong statement. So statement 1 A says that it will benefit domestic manufacturers, also helps in creating employment. Statement B, it promotes the production of high value products in the country and increase the value addition in exports. Statement C, it reduces the import dependence of a country. And statement D, the scheme is applicable only to electronic products and medical devices. So when you look into these four statements, based on the discussion, we can say that statement A, B and C is correct. But when you look at statement D, you can find that this statement says that this scheme is applicable only to electronic products and medical devices. Here you should know that this scheme is not only limited to these two sectors, but it is expanded to many sectors like food processing, telecom, electronics, textiles, automobiles, etc. So based on this analysis, we can come to a conclusion that the incorrect option among these four is option D. Look at this prelims question. It wants us to identify the organization that releases the Human Capital Index. The options provided are International Labour Organization, World Bank, International Monetary Fund and Asian Development Bank. So as we know, this Human Capital Index is a report that is prepared by the World Bank, which measures about the countries that are best in mobilizing the economic and professional potential of its citizens. So therefore, the right answer is option B, that is World Bank. The list of mains practice question is displayed here. You can write your answers and post them in the comment section below. With this, we have come to the end of today's news analysis. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC Civil Services preparation.